Alright.
Do you guys do that nap thing here? Jump up and nap thing. Everyone, like on three, we clap.
So, we haven't done it yet.
Really? So let's clap in. So do like this and 3, 2, 1. Okay, now we can start. So my name is Alan Lodd and I'm a programmer and a farmer and everything else. So today, again here, we talk about animals, about keeping animals inside permaculture systems, using them as tools, and so, how many of you have kept animals? Which kind, like chickens?
Chickens, cows, sheep.
Cool. Crocodiles, no? First of all, if you start raising animals, you need to be very sure about this. There are so many people who like getting chickens or sheep and they end up abandoned and almost dead. It's a commitment, basically. And like if you take cows, you have to make them every day, morning and afternoon. Sheep and chicken is easier. That's why you need sheep and chickens. And I've developed systems, some of it which you can see here, that let me keep sheep without wasting lots of time. Because I don't like repetitive tasks. I optimize them out and I'll talk about them a bit later. So first, if you make the decision, I need to keep some animals, I need animals for some permaculture systems, or I need some produce from them, like eggs from chickens, or within the chicken output needs diagram. And so after you make the decision, you need to decide if you want to keep them for like for some produce for yourself, you want to sell the produce, or you want to learn keeping animals. Like all the old farmers I've talked to, every one of them said, you want to start keeping animals, take a few sheep. Because they're like, they're really easy to keep. They're hardy. They don't die that fast. You see, there's something wrong. And for my own experience, if something happens, like you hang around the sheep and someone steps on their foot, it's no big deal. Imagine a cow weighing a ton stepping on their foot. That's like permanent. And if they're aggressive, they just bump you a little bit. But if a cow is aggressive, that's it. So it's a good way to learn animal psychology, basically. Herd behavior, and I've learned a lot about mammals in general, including humans. The herd behavior, especially. And if you want to keep animals for income, then you can't skip the learning phase. And it's much cheaper to start with a few animals, make huge mistakes, lose a few animals maybe, instead of starting off with like 100 sheep or 1,000 sheep and then losing everything. You just make small mistakes and small cheap mistakes basically. And you have to decide how much time are you willing to give for a sheep. After the initial phase of joy and newness and everything fades out, first you have lots of time for them, they're like your firstborn child or something. But after a while, at some point they are like a chore. You need to do it. You don't feel like if you're sick in the winter, you need to do it. have to take into account that when you are feeling down, you need to deal with animals anyway. And you have to decide how many. If you take one chicken, it will die of stress. If you take two, it's a bit iffy. Three, two of them will gang up on the one and kill it, maybe, usually. So four is the minimum. Four chickens. And that means you get four eggs a day. It might not seem a lot, but it's a lot. At some point I ate like 10 eggs per day, every day. I'm an eggs day now. I think. I don't want to eat them anymore. But with sheep, you need two. If you take one, it will die of stress because it's a herd animal. It will feel very stressed and unsafe when it's alone. And it will just scream. I had a goat alone for 2 weeks and it just screamed for 2 weeks. It thought it was away from the herd. They have this function, if they are too far from the herd, they start screaming until the herd finds them or they want to hurry. And yeah, for pigs, I've heard that if you keep one pig as a pet, it's like a dog, it's fine because it can socialize with you, with the family. But usually it's like two or three is okay. And with chickens also, I've heard the maximum is, like the soft limit is like 400, 500. In the industrial settings they have thousands and thousands of chickens. But then again they have people collecting the dead chickens there. Because if you have to put too many chickens into a crowded space, they start killing the weakest ones. They're like dinosaurs, they're ruthless. And they will kill if they feel stressed, if they feel that they don't have enough food. There's so many factors. So if your chickens are stressed, the first sign is you don't get any eggs. And the second sign is they start killing each other. Don't arrive at that point. With cows, you need to put like two, because one of them will be pregnant and will birth, and at some point you don't get any milk from the cow, and if you have two you can at least get milk year round. Yeah, so one part, how many of you are vegetarians here? Okay, so no slaughtering talk maybe. So one important part especially in animals, with chickens it's easier. Like you can have one cockerel and lots of hens, and it's fine. Like the chickens lay the eggs even without the cockerel. They need the cockerel for the eggs to be fertilized if you want to get chicks. But with like most common chicken breeds out here in Estonia, at least, like the ones from Antumais and well, basically every large breed, they don't hatch. They might have the instinct to hatch for a few days. I've had one hatch for a week, and then it's like, okay, I'm through this. Goodbye. So you need like old time chickens, like ancient breeds from old farmer. They're usually like small, like crow-like, little tiny bit, but you can put like 10 or 9 eggs under them and hatch it up. But I would prefer hatching them in an incubator. It's more control and you can get more chicks from them. But with sheep, if you have male sheep and female sheep, you know what happens. And if they're sister and brother, they don't care. So you need to do something about it. You need to do something that the males can't breed. So there are many, many ways you can achieve that. First of all, you can cut their balls off. Like, usually take a knife when they're born or a few weeks old and just cut the balls off. I haven't done it, so I don't really enjoy that. Second thing is like a little rubber band you put around the balls. Like you have like these special pliers and you put the rubber band around. It doesn't hurt for them. Besides the first stress of you catching them and touching their balls. But after like a few months, the balls will dry up and fall off. It's like when you take some rubber bands and put around your arm, they just dry off and fall off. But if that time happens to be August, like my first time, then you have a problem. Because there will be a wound there and it will start to rot a bit, then the flies will go into it. So you have to time the lambs. By the time the castration is done, so it will be mid-May or June or something. That's another thing, timing. With chickens, it's easy. You can take the egg, and if you don't want the chickens to hatch from the egg, you just take it away from the chicken and everything is fine. But with mammals, it's inside them, so you can't really take their eggs. And you have to time the lambs. If you have sheep wire varieties that aren't cold hardy, like Estonian native sheep, I have a Estonian native sheep, but others that are less cold hardy, if they give birth during winter, during a snowstorm, some lambs will die. But even I lose lambs all the time. When they're lambing, the first time it's a bit traumatic, but it's a part of life, basically. Some lambs will die, some lambs will come out with then. Don't use any medications and any extra feed and stuff, it will happen. And it's totally random. It's not even related to the weather. I have a friend who has 500 sheep and it's like, he says some years, just some lambs die. Some years, few lambs die. It's like random. It's totally random. So another way, which I would prefer to keep the is like an alternative for castration, is just keeping the males separate from the females. They will get a little rowdy there, because you put a lot of males without the female inside a confined area. They will start showing off to each other and try to pump each other. But it's fine, as long as they're not down from the females. If they get the scent, the hormones from the females, they just go crazy. I did try separating one male from the flock, my breeding male, and I put him on a leash, and just sometimes he happened to be downwind, and those days he was really, really aggressive. But usually he's like a dog, he just comes up and wants like a best friend, but not when I separated him from females. He was quite mad about it, actually. Yeah, he didn't like it. Sheep will breed year round, they don't care, but so, of course, I don't know how, but they give birth at the same time. So basically, they come to it at the same time. It's a part of the herd thing again, it's more safer if you give birth at the same time. Yeah. With peas and gouda, I don't have that much experience, you have to Google that. But yeah, with cows it's very technical and very difficult. We need more experience with that. Lambs are pregnant about like 4 or 5 months, I don't know exactly how much we should know. And with chickens it's exactly 21 days. 21 days, yeah. Every time. And if you have chickens hatching out chicks, you need to check the eggs, smell the eggs a bit. If they smell, you discard the egg and put in a fake egg or just make it's important that the message around, like every egg needs to batch generate. That's why you have 9 or 7 or 11 eggs in a nest, never every egg number, because you have a hole in there and that egg will only take hole. But, yeah, but
what's the problem? Do it break or?
Chicken accidentally breaks the egg, you need to wash the other eggs. If it smells, it might discard everything. That's why I like the incubator, it's not that leafy. If the chicken, like if you stress the chicken, or if other chickens are stressing, that chicken might break the hatching. You need to separate the hatching the chicken and separate the feed. I separate them and they act differently. Like when a chicken starts hatching, it makes a weird sound like this. And then you know it's like, yeah. And if you try to take its eggs and it starts to peck at you really aggressively, then you know it's protecting the eggs. Otherwise, they don't care. So you need to separately feed and water the chicken. Yeah, keep it out of noise and stuff like that. For sheep it's easier if they are pregnant, they don't care, they react like normal. But the closer you get to birth, you should give them some new minerals. They sell these mineral, like 10 kilo cubes of minerals. They're bio-certified. It's basically salt and calcium and stuff like that, and they need that. And I also give them, if they cut down some tree, I give them that, or some Christmas trees. They need the vitamins from there. If you feed them only hay, they're going to be vitamin deficient, because it's dry hay, it doesn't have vitamin C. Have any questions at this point?
How many lambs did you have?
Right now I have 4 lambs and 0 chickens. I lost the chickens. I had a livestock guardian dog guarding them, and since the chickens aren't very intellectual companions, I let dog with the sheep, and a week passed and morning, 36 chickens were just dead. And that's a good point actually. If your chickens are missing and they're like little nests or piles of feathers, then it's a fox. If nothing's there, then it's a hawk. Funnily enough, I haven't had any problems with hawks. I've seen them stalk my chickens, but I guess they're only a threat for chicks, but not for full-grown chickens. And another good service that the Cockerel offers actually is they're like ear scanners, they're like radars. Chickens, like the female chickens, they don't scan around, but the Cockerels scan around, and if there's some threat, like a hawk or fox or whatever, or stranger, then they will alert the chickens and everyone will flee to some shade, so under a tree or under whatever. Yeah. Any other questions?
Just a comment. My experience is that the ducks are also scanning, but not as well as geese. So some people keep together geese and chickens. So
geese are really aggressive too. Really aggressive. So with chickens, there's this myth that you need to feed them grain. Do you know where chickens are from originally? Anyone?
Southeast Asia.
Yeah, from jungle. The jungle animals. Last time I checked, well, there's not much grain growing in jungles. So chickens, they usually eat anything that's dropped to the ground, any fruits or any piece of vegetation. And you can really successfully feed chickens with food scraps. If you have lots of food scraps, like cabbage and everything, roots and...
Do they eat any kind of scrap?
They eat anything. You have to be careful with that. You can't eat, feed them anything really spicy, really salty, really sweet, and really acidic, like citrus. But they really eat anything. They really eat chicken too. They love chicken. It's their favorite.
There's one. And there's exactly one thing that you shouldn't feed them. That's avocado.
That's what?
Avocado.
Good thing I don't like avocado.
Like, no part of avocado, it's poisonous.
So do you keep your chickens like that? Or did you keep them feeding like on this basis?
I use various techniques. I just experiment a lot. And first I just fed them chicken feed from Star. It's really expensive. It contains soy and pepper. It's not really eco-friendly. And I wouldn't eat that. So basically, I have a rule that if I wouldn't eat whatever I'm feeding my animals, I don't give you money. Except for sheep.
So you eat like hay.
I taste hay, it's quite sweet, but I don't have the little extra organ to chew it, so yeah. People do smoothies with hay anyways, yeah.
It's healthy.
Yeah.
So what was their diet, if I may ask?
What?
What was their diet then?
At the point where when I was feeding them grain, I fed them English kai.
Oats.
Oats, yeah. 30% oats, 30% wheat, 30%
barley.
Barley. But if they had a chance, they would eat just wheat. And it's really sweet. I also, it's really important to feed them some grit, like gravel or sand, so they can chew it up. They have this little organ here, little muscle. They collect stones and pieces of glass and everything, and then it grinds their food. They don't chew it. So when you kill a chicken, it's really interesting to see what's in here. Yeah. So then you know where they have grazed, and it's really disturbing to find places.
During Soviet times, they used to sell these organs at stores for eating.
It's a muscle. It's okay, yeah.
Breastbones?
No, without this organ. Without, I think.
The sheep have a similar organ before their stomach. It's like this big, and it has hundreds of little fleshy teeth, so it grinds the grass. And my dog really likes that. It's really user friendly. You take the organ and you can peel that part with the little teeth. It's like a package. It's really cool. The same with chicken. You can peel everything. So I'm going to show you how I start working with the chickens. This is my first chicken tractor. Yeah. And this whole experience. I saw these pictures of permaculture chicken tractors online, so I thought I'd build one. It weighs like a ton.
We have one.
Yeah. If you build a chicken tractor, you need to take into account that you need to move it every day, even if you're sick. Again. If your back is out, then you're screwed. So the second version, as you can see here, is smaller. The dimensions are for you, they're random, because I just I have this car trailer, and at some point in time I was living between my city house and my farm, so I moved house every year, and I need to transport these, so they are the size of my trailer. You can put two of them. And they're really light. And I've open sourced the design. If you want, you can make it later. So, but
are you happy with it?
Yeah, basically. It's better than the right one. But like you can see, the net here is this square net. It's called, it's welded. It's really strong, but here I cheaped out and used this bound together cheapo net that even the chickens can break. It's crap, don't use that. It's a total crap.
We call that chicken wire.
It's crap, yeah.
So, but if you would have this, like, the same structure and design and just a bit...